Morning. Please bow your heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here this morning and worship you and learn more about you, Lord. I pray that you will open our hearts as you receive your word from the pastor today. And I pray that you keep everyone safe and maybe on their way. And I pray they arrive safely. Pray that we will continue to serve you throughout the day today. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Precious. Thank you, Lord.
Open our ears and our hearts and our minds that we may see you and hear you, Father, and just receive your word today, Father. And Lord, it's in Jesus' name that we pray. We ask that you would bless again, Lord, those who may be on their way. Let them arrive safely and ready to hear from you today, Lord. Just meet us here, Father, and surround us with your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
God will direct your steps. Proverbs 16:4. Are you saved from the wrath of God? Do you know that Jesus is your only hope? Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Run into his arms. Do it today before it's too late. The word for today: the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Exodus 14:14. Bible study Wednesday night. Bible study is canceled until further notice due to repairs within the Sheffield Community Center. We encourage you to read and hear the Gospel of John chapter 3:5 and allow the word, allow the Lord to speak to your heart as you prepare your heart for the next week's message. Resource table. The resource table is filled with many Christian books, magazine pamphlets, tracts, music, movies, and other resources to help you to understand God's word and to grow in the grace and knowledge of who he is. All resources are available for free to sign up for your usage. Please stop by after service today. Free copies of COF services. Audio recording of COF services are available upon request. To request copies of any Sunday service, please sign up at the resource table. Also, all messages will be posted on YouTube by typing in Sunday Church Service, COF. COF event. COF will be going to see Lecrae and Andy Minow live in concert October 29th at the Fillmore Theater in Silver Spring, Maryland. If you are interested, please see Joshua Jones. Christian birthdays. If your birthday occurred in the month of August, please stand. We would like to thank Jesus for another year of life. Opportunity to serve. Here at Christian Outreach Fellowship, there are many opportunities to serve. If you would like to serve in any ministry, here and can be faithful, committed. Your gifts and talents are welcome and needed. To request more information regarding any ministry, please see Pastor Jones after service or sign up at the resource table. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. 1 Peter 4:10. And we shall serve the Lord your God, and he will shall bless thy bread and that water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. Exodus 23:25. So we stand and we greet one another.
Time.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing? Everyone doing well?
Great.
Thank the Lord for another day. You know, we come into the house of the Lord and we come with a grateful heart. Amen. I pray that everyone here who is listening to my voice has a grateful heart. Do you all have a grateful heart? I pray that that you're thankful. I just want to share from Genesis chapter 4 as we talk about the offering this morning. I'll read verse 1. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain. And said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. And I just love that about Eve, is that she knew that her child came from God. And this shows that I believe that we'll see Eve one day, we'll say, Eve, why'd you do that? But she may say to us, well, why'd you do that? You know? But whatever be the case, I think she was a believer. And verse 2 says, then she bore again, and this time his brother, and his name was Abel. Now Abel was the keeper of the sheep, was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, this is years, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. But verse 4 says, Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord had respect of Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. You know what's interesting is that it says that Cain brought forth from the ground an offering, the fruit of the ground to the Lord. And it appears that when Cain, you know, I believe that God required a blood sacrifice even back then, but Cain brought forth his offering, his sacrifice to the Lord. And it appears that there was no effort in it. There was no desire to be extra pleasing to God. But when it came to Abel, it says, Abel also brought forth the firstborn of his flock. Wow. Meaning that, you know, the one that was the very best is usually seen as the first. And he brought forth the firstborn. And not only that, it speaks to Jesus. And he also gave the fat thereof to God. And we talked about the fat in here before, how it smells so good. You know, we had steak the other day. And I'm glad, I think I got the one, Lisa, that had the fattiest part in it. And it was so good, you know. But the fat belongs to the Lord. And so he gave that to God in a sacrificial way. And I just pray as we give to the Lord this morning that it be the first fruits of our offering. It be the very best, the firstborn of our flock. The first thing we do with our paychecks is to give to God. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give this morning. We pray, Father, that you would bless us as we seek to please you in this area of giving. We pray, Father, that this would follow us all the days of our life, that we will always give, whether it be 10%, 20%, 50%, sometimes 100%. We just pray, Father, that it be our attitude and it'll be right before you as we give to build your kingdom. Bless all those who give this morning, Lord. Give them more seed to sow into your kingdom and provide for us here, Lord. Let our cup runneth over in this area. We thank you and we love you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We have a song this morning, and it's by Brian Courtney Wilson, and the name of it is Greater Works. And, you know, it's kind of stuck in my head recently. I don't know the words, so I won't bore you all with my crazy voice and singing any of it. But the song speaks about how that Jesus said that you shall do greater works than me. And I pray, Father, that we would do, and what he meant was in the sense that we would do more, I think greater in number, not necessarily greater in the ability of the things which Jesus did, but I think greater in number, meaning seeing that there's so many believers out here who know Christ as opposed to just Jesus and his 12. Now we have millions of Christians who could do so much now for the kingdom of God. Can we all stand and worship the Lord together?
Sometimes there are obstacles in the road that can leave you feeling low, and you don't know how to move forward. And sometimes there are turns you want to take, but the way gets hard to trace. Now you're wondering, how did you get here? But don't you give up until you see how God is ordering your steps so you can walk into your seats. Healing has begun, a great work in you is faithful to perform. God is faithful to perform. Healing has begun, a great work in you is faithful to perform. Our God is
created for good works, God, to bring you glory. Help us to know, Lord, that you who begun a good work in us will complete it. And you'll be faithful to perform it. We love you, Lord. Now let my words be yours. Be glorified in everything I say and do. As always, give us ears to hear. Open our hearts so we may understand all that is in your law, God, and in your word. We love you, Daddy. Be with anyone who's on their way. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Can we turn to Job, the book of Job? It's going to be our verse of the day. Got a lot that we'd like to cover today. As always, Spend time in the scriptures that you've been given. Study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Make sure that you put yourself in a position that you can be like Mary, sitting at the feet of Jesus. Amen. Learning the things of God. Remember, she chose the better thing. And so, you know, just before service started today, this verse, God just put this verse on my heart. I don't know who it's for, but as I speak this, hopefully it will encourage you all to obey God. Remember in the book of Job, the Lord appeared to Job in a whirlwind after Job had all these questions about what God was doing and the rest of that. And after Job's friends had said these things which were wrong about Job and about God, God told Job finally in Job chapter 42, he said, I want you to go. And first of all, he told his friends, he told Eliphaz, he says, you have spoken wrong against my friend or my servant Job in verse 7. And so the Lord has spoken these words to Job, that the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is aroused against you and your friends, for you have spoken of me for what is really not right. You said something that's not right about my servant Job. Now therefore take 7 bullocks, and God told him, because of that, I want you to make a sacrifice, and then I want you to go to Job and have Job pray for you. So that's what happened in verse 9. They went to Job and said, you know, they made their sacrifices and then asked Job to pray for them, and Job prayed for them. And it says in verse 10, and the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. And I just want to share that, you know, lots of times we look at our lives and we say, well, Lord, why is it that, you know, I'm not moving forward in certain areas? Well, you know what? Lots of times it's because we got things against other people that we really have not dealt with. And it says that God blessed Job. And it goes on to say they gave him twice as much and so forth for all the things that he had went through. But God didn't give Job these things until he prayed for those who had done him wrong. I got to say, in my own life, I've had times where it's been long periods where, you know, some folks have done me wrong and I've been upset about it. Not that I was, you know, I had a root of bitterness or anything, I don't think, but I was hurt by what they had done. And I remember getting to the point where I could actually pray for them. That felt so good. And so I just want to encourage you all this morning. In many cases, our blessings are being held up because we haven't forgiven someone for something they've done to us. And you know you're there when you've forgiven them, when you can get to the point that you are willing to pray for them. Amen? Amen. I hope that encouraged someone's heart. Know your Bible. As I have here on the board, know your Bible, okay? Now, Matthew 19, verse 26, which is one of our memory verses, says that all things are all things are what?
All things are lawful.
No, that's from 1 Corinthians 6, 12.
Please, possible.
Yes, but all things, now you're coming here, but all things are, keep going, possible.
Possible.
Keep going. With God, all things are what? Possible, or some translations put it, all things are possible with God. Okay? Now y'all got that. All right? That's Matthew 19, 26. Mark 9, 23 says, all things are possible to them that what? Believe. I'll put this up here. Okay? And then we're told in Genesis 18, verse 14. Y'all remember that verse? Is there anything too hard for God? So if we put these verses together, these are three great verses that we should all memorize, which we've talked about in before. One is Genesis 18, 14. You can always start in the Old Testament and work your way up. Genesis 18, verse 14 says, is there anything too hard for God? So if you find yourself in a situation where you're, Lord, I just need this bill paid, Lord, or I need my health dealt with, Lord, I need something to move on my job or my finances, or maybe my car won't start. Is there anything too hard for God? Next thing is, guess what? Then you say to yourself, hey, you know what? Matthew 19, 26 says, you know, all things are possible with God, right? So is anything too hard for God? Genesis 18, 14. Matthew 19:26, all things are possible with God. And then you go back, then you go down to Mark 9:23. And then you say to yourself, and this is the last part of the recipe, all things are possible if I just believe. Amen. So I want y'all to keep this tandem together in your head this upcoming week. Next thing to keep in mind, and we know that God can do all things. Amen. Can God do anything? Can God do everything? Can God do everything? Can God do anything? Yeah, that's that term is a good old term that people use, which is true. God cannot sin. Okay. What else? God cannot lie. Okay. I want to name two important things. Okay, the scripture clearly points out that God cannot do. First of all, God cannot change. Malachi 3:6 says, I'm the Lord God, I change not. So God cannot change. Right? Does this mean that God changes? Does this mean that God can't change his mind? What does it mean when it says God can't change? What was that? His ways, which is known as his nature. Exodus 34, verse 7 and 6 and 7 talks about how God is loving, he's kind, he's merciful, but he will not clear the guilty, and he'll, you know. So these are different aspects of God's nature. They never change. But that doesn't mean that God doesn't do things differently, right? That doesn't mean that if God decides to destroy a nation in that nation, like the book of Nineveh, like in the book of Nineveh, when it's in their situations, it does not mean that God does not change what he's doing. Now, I know that some have said, well, they changed. God never changed. They changed. No, God did decide not to bring judgment on them. Okay? We know that God is doing a new thing now. In the Old Testament, we were under a different covenant. Now we're under a new covenant. So God is doing things different. So that doesn't mean, so just keep in mind, it doesn't mean that God doesn't do things differently. It doesn't mean that God does not change in the direction in which he's going. But his nature, who he is, never changes. Does that make sense? Another thing that God cannot do is God, as Joshua pointed out, cannot lie. And so it says in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 18, and you all can turn to Titus chapter 1, verse 2. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 18 says that there's two immutable things that God can't do. One is that God cannot lie, okay? All right? So, you know, look at Titus 1, 2. In Titus chapter 1, verse 2, it says, now, if you have an NIV, it's unfortunate. It says that God doesn't lie. The ESV, NASB, King James, New King James all say the same thing. God cannot lie. Okay? I think that's a better translation. God cannot lie. This is something God just can't do. Amen? So if he's made a promise, you can be sure that he will fulfill it. Amen? So we looked at things that God can do, the things God cannot do. Amen? Next thing I want to point out, and I just want you all to ask, because this is part of knowing your Bible, I want you all to tell me if this verse is correct from 1 Timothy 6. Money is the root of all evil. Is that verse correct? What is it? What should we say? The love of money. Is a good word. Every week I'll come up with one, you know, just to give you a clue for next week. All those that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Amen? Is that correct? No, thank you. We'll look at that next week. Amen? So, our next thing of the day is our news of the day. And I'd like to bring this up, our news of the day. As you all know, this past week, Aretha Franklin passed. Aretha Franklin was involved with, I don't know how many different gospel songs. I would say probably 50, you know, in her lifetime. She grew up in a church where her father was one of the most renowned pastors in this country. He was well known at the time, just like, you know, the T.T. Jakes and so forth for this day. Well, she grew up in a household like that because that's what her dad was. And so she grew up singing gospel in the church. What's interesting about it, though, as she got older, she started finding herself involved in secular music. And unfortunately, her dad encouraged it, okay? But whatever be the case, I saw an interview with her, and they asked her, they said, you know, a lot of this music you made, because you grew up in the church, you kind of got off into some of this other music, like, you know, Sock It To Me and some of these other songs. And they asked her, they said, is that a good Christian? Was that Christian? She said, no. And she dogmatically said, no, it was not. That was secular music that I was singing. And I thought that was interesting that she really made it clear that maybe she had gotten off the beaten path. She had gotten off the path of doing the right thing. And this was like, this interview was probably about 4 years ago. And what's also interesting about it is that just as you look at the life of Aretha Franklin, they say she lived a very troubled life. And a lot of it has to do with her, I believe, losing her focus when it came to the things of God, messing with unbelievers and the rest of this foolishness. And we know from Proverbs 13, verse 15, the way of the transgressor is hard. So anyway, I do believe in the end that she came back to know Jesus. I do believe she spent her last days because that's how she grew up. And I believe that she called on the name of the Lord. And I'm hoping to see her again one day. We were talking about it recently, how that Lisa, your mom, probably just this past week got to meet Aretha Franklin. You know what I'm saying? And but your mom will be greater in the kingdom of God than she will. Wow. You start thinking about that. Not only that, but it says in Revelation 20, verse 12, that, and it reminded me of this, Revelation 20, verse 12, when it comes to the unbeliever at the great white throne judgment, it says that John says, I saw the books, and a book was opened. And just understand, when it comes to the unbeliever, God has a whole list of books. And these books are the activities, it appears, that what unbelievers do. And these books will be used against them because their names will not be found written in the Lamb's Book of Life, as the small and great will stand before the Lord. Next thing that was in the news is this whole thing, and then we'll move on, about the priest. And, you know, I really haven't kept up with this, but I'm telling y'all, over a thousand children up here in Pennsylvania were molested or sexually assaulted by priests. Turn to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. I mean, and these were children who had come to church to learn about Jesus, to learn about the things of God. And what just blows my mind is that there were close to or over 1,000 of them over the years. And look at what it says here in verse 1. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And then Jesus called a little child to him, and he set him in the midst of them. And he said, surely I say unto you, unless you are converted and become as a little child or as little children, you will by no means enter into the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whosoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. And then he says in verse 6, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me, and this may be a humble believer or maybe a little young child, to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he was drowned in the depths of the sea. And what he's saying is, see, back then a criminal, if he had committed a capital crime, they would take a stone, a millstone. And these were stones they used to grind material up. And they could weigh 300-400 pounds. And they would take them and they would tie up this particular person. They would tie his hands behind his back, tie his feet up, and then take him out in the middle of the sea and take this great big stone and tie it around his neck. And then they would throw the stone over into the sea. And that person would drop right to the bottom and drown. Jesus said it would be better if that happened to a person than they messed with one of these little kids. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4. And this stuff angers me. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And I'm going to tell you why this junk happens in the Catholic Church. Who I am within my thinking and my understanding of what they believe, as I have taught in here before, these folks are no more than a cult. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter times It says some would depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits, doctrines of demons. There are certain doctrines, certain teachings that demons have put in the church. And one of them is speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience sealed with the hot iron. And look what it says. They, in verse 3, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from certain foods. Who else does this but the Catholic Church, where their priests are not allowed to marry? And then they wonder why they start messing with the little kids. And they go around talking about, well, Peter wasn't married. Some foolishness that they have made up. We know from Mark 1:29 that Peter was married. And because they're not allowed to marry, a lot of this junk goes on. In fact, let me just say this, within the Catholic Church, priests are allowed to smoke cigarettes. Your body is the temple of God. I confronted one in the park one day. I said, what you doing, bro? Smoking cigarettes. And because of that, guess what's happened now? The question has come up in the Catholic Church. Well, I guess, you know, if priests can smoke cigarettes, then maybe they can smoke weed. Because one of the things they say, well, they're legal. Well, weed has become legal. I guess they can smoke that too. And drink alcohol. Stay away from that place. And let me just say this to the Methodist Church. I don't know if they made the vote, but they will be, if they haven't already, will be voting on whether to ordain gay pastors. Stay away from that place. As soon as you see the term Methodist. And let me just say this. Now, the African Methodist, the AME Church, the African Methodist Church, is quite different. They have gone against this. But I'm telling you, in this society right now, they say 68% of people believe that gay marriage is okay. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Numbers 14:24, I will be like Caleb. I will, Numbers 14:24, have a different spirit. People have lost their what? Cotton picking mind. Anyway, let's move on from that. God gives us pop quizzes at times, doesn't he? How many remember being in school getting a pop quiz? How many remember that? How many of y'all like pop quizzes? Raise your hand. Most people don't like it. What you don't like about a pop quiz? Catch you off guard. You're not ready. You're not prepared. Let me just say this. The Lord expects us. The Lord expects us to apply what we've been taught. He don't expect you just to go to church and just get information and go about your life. He expects us to take that information and apply it in our everyday life, what we've been taught. So what you learn this week, then guess what? God may give you a pop quiz. And just lots of times to show you where you at in your relationship with him. How many struggle with patience? Raise your hand. And guess what? This upcoming week, the Lord may put you in a situation. Well, guess what? You can make it. You can help you. You're in that area when it comes to your patience. Y'all feeling me on that? Maybe you got a problem with, you know, with, I don't know, with eating. Maybe God put somebody in your life who can help you to stop eating. Are y'all feeling me on this? So let's just understand the things that you're learning. God will all of a sudden at times give you a pop quiz. Remember Genesis chapter 22? Abraham's going, you know, just doing his thing. He's got his lovely, great, his awesome son, young boy. Well, he's, at that time, Isaac is probably a young man, maybe some believe in his early 20s. And God says to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to offer your son, your only son, Isaac, up on Mount Moriah, the same place in which Jesus was crucified. Wow. I mean, remember, he named Isaac. Isaac's name means laughter. He loved Isaac. He loved that little boy. I mean, that was his boy. You know what I'm saying? And God says, I got a test for you. I want you to take him up there and sacrifice him for me. Wow. And guess what Abraham do? Next day, Abraham gets up, takes the boy with him. And they hit up there. And Abraham takes a knife and proceeds to sacrifice his son to God. And God calls out from heaven and says twice, And I believe he had to say it twice because Abraham was so intent on obeying God. He said, Abraham, Abraham, do not harm the land. You remember what God said in Genesis chapter 22, verse 12? He says, now I know that you love me, that you fear me, and there's nothing you won't withhold from me. And sometimes God allows us to be tested, sometimes just to show us where we at, and to show us now that he knows. Now we know that he knows where we at in our relationship with him. Remember Mark chapter 6, sternly, Mark chapter 6. Daytime Bible study, this is where we're at in Mark chapter 6. Jesus feeds a multitude of roughly 8,000 people with a few fishes and a few pieces of bread. He feeds the people. He multiplies them. He multiplies the food miraculously and provides for them. Sends the people away. And guess what he does? He tells his disciples, you know, I'll meet you on the other side. And you know, he sent them in a boat and they get on this boat. And here they are rowing and the storm comes up and they see Jesus walking on the water and he almost walks by them. And they say, you know, help. And then Jesus said, don't be afraid, it is I. And then Peter said, if it's you, Lord, then bid that I come out of this boat and walk on the water to you. And all of a sudden, the Lord said, come. And Peter gets out the boat and he starts walking to Jesus. Remember, and he almost drowns and he looks and he says, help to Jesus. And Jesus reaches down and says, oh, ye little faith, why did you doubt? And then Jesus raises him up and then both of them walk back to the boat. You know, Peter and the man walking on the water, man, what a thing. You know what I'm saying? But when they get to the other side, scripture says that this happened for a reason. And it says that it happened. If you read the end of Mark chapter 6, and I'll read in verse, okay, somewhat near the end of verse 52. It says, I'll start in verse 51. Then he went into the boat to them, and the wind ceased, and they were greatly amazed in themselves beyond measure and marveled, for they had not understood about the loaves because their heart was hardened. Do you realize that part of the reason that they went through this storm was so that they would realize who Jesus was? And evidently, by him supplying all this for 8,000 people, through that whole process, they learned nothing. And because of that, God said, I got to teach him even a deeper lesson. And so the point being is, let me say this. This upcoming week, God may give you a test. And it may be based upon the stuff that you learned here this morning. Let's get an A. Amen. Let's not get a C. But let's try to get an A. And apply what our Father teaches us today about who Jesus is. Amen? Can I get an amen? Now, let's deal with our lesson of the day. And remember, we've been dealing with three enemies. Who are they again? Somebody help me out? World flesh and the devil. Turn to Matthew chapter 16. Remember, we said the worst of these, Matthew 16, 25, was the flesh. Okay? Remember, we left off talking about what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, verse 25. He said, he that seeketh to save his life will lose it, but he that loses it for my name's sake, that's the one that will find it. One of the things that's important for us to understand is that there's a battle going on within us. Where we're seeking to be successful, we're seeking to have and so forth and to succeed. And God is really not interested in that, believe it or not. He's interested in building the kingdom of God. So lots of times our desires conflict with his. Because lots of times, even though, you know, you find people and you say, man, they're working hard. They're trying to get ahead. No, they're just working in their flesh to build their own little kingdom down here on earth. Instead of looking to build up the kingdom of God. In fact, look what it says in verse 23. We saw from last week, Jesus said to Peter. Because remember, Jesus said that he would die, he would be crucified and all the rest of this. And remember, Peter said, far be it from you that happened. And Jesus said, I rebuke you, Satan. You care for the things of men, Matthew 16, 23, rather than the things of God. He was so consumed. Remember we said before, when we get to the point where we want to save our lives, we're in trouble. See, as believers, it's no longer about us, it's all about Jesus. Do you remember the time that Jesus is walking in Luke chapter 9, verse 60? Y'all can turn it, y'all ain't doing nothing else. Jesus walking. And all of a sudden, Josh, a man runs up to Jesus. Jesus, what's that? He said, look, you, in so many words, he was saying, Jesus, you're amazing. I will follow you wherever you go. You remember what Jesus said to him? Birds of the air have nests, foxes have holes, yes. But the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. You know what he was saying in so many words? If you follow me, guess what? You ain't gonna have nowhere to live. You sure you want this thing? You know what I'm saying? And then right after that, it says that all of a sudden, guess what? Jesus walks up to a man and he says, follow me. And this guy says, listen, I'll follow you, but let me first go bury my dad. And Jesus said, listen, because see, back then, you know, what that really meant was, I'll come and follow you, but at first I got to bury my pops. Your dad could be like 42. Meaning, I'll follow you once my dad dies. Jesus said, listen, let the dead bury the dead. You come follow me and build the kingdom of God. And then all of a sudden, the man comes up in verse 60 to Jesus again and says, I'll follow you wherever you go, but let me first. Now, he pulled the Elisha thing that Elisha had pulled on Elijah in the Old Testament. He said, let me first go say goodbye to my family members. And Jesus said, listen, if you want to follow me, anybody who puts their hand to the plow and looks back is not fit to be my disciple. You're not fit for the kingdom of God. I somewhat believe that there may be a difference between a believer and a disciple. I can't scripturally point that out, but there's the belief that some people are believers and then some people are disciples. It's hard to say, because I don't think scripture makes a distinction. But whatever be the case, sometimes it seems that way, because some people are just not dedicated to Jesus. Turn over to 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3. Excuse me, 2 Timothy chapter 3. Look at what God tells us in verse 1. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times, dangerous times will come. We're living in dangerous times. For when men will be lovers of themselves, or lovers, I'm sorry, yeah, of themselves, lovers of money, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemous, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. So such people stay away from. Some people are lovers. You ever meet a lover? Have you ever met a lover before? Some people are lovers of themselves. You know, how many remember Lot in the Old Testament? Lot was the nephew of Abraham. God called Abraham. There's no indication that God called Lot, but hey, cool, Lot came to know God from hanging out with his uncle Abraham. And that's a cool thing. I got relatives who came to know the Lord as we hung out together. All of a sudden, God is blessing Abraham, Josh. Abraham is really blessed. All of a sudden, it's Francis. God is blessing Lot. They both got everything. And then it's just the land can't sustain both of them. So Abraham comes up to Lot and says, look, man, you know, the guys who you got working for you and the guys I got working for me keep getting into it. Listen, why don't we divide? I'll give you whatever land you want. I like Abraham. He was so mature. See, at that point, Lot should have said, look, man, you're the older one, you're my uncle, whatever you choose. He didn't say that. He was selfish. He was a lover of himself. So guess what Lot said? He said, I'll take that land over there. Guess what that land was? That land was the area in which Sodom and Gomorrah was at. The Bible says it was well watered. It was just the perfect spot. He said, I'll take that, and his greedy behavior. And so guess what Lot did, Josh? He took that land and he went, and the Bible says that he pitched his tent towards Sodom. Guess what Abraham did once Lot left? Does anybody remember? It says that Abraham went and he built an altar to the Lord and he worshiped the Lord. He's worshiping the Lord, but Lot is sitting there watching porn. Because he's looking at what's going on down in Sodom, and so that shit before his father said, man, that place is so wicked. By telling his friends, man, you can't believe the stuff. Before you know it, we find out. Abraham gets a phone call. Ring, ring, ring. He said, what's going on, Abraham? Man, look, they done took your nephew Lot captive. And they said, how did they get captive? He was living down in Sodom. He moved down in Sodom. Abraham comes and rescues him and everything else. And the homosexual kings of Sodom say, hey, look, man, we give you whatever you want, man. We give you a share of what you wanted, man, for saving us. And Abraham said, man, I want none of y'all stuff unless y'all say y'all made me rich. That's why let me just say, that's why you'd be very careful what you accept from an unbeliever. A few chapters later, Genesis chapter 19. God says he's gonna destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Y'all turn there, Genesis 19. All of a sudden, God sends angels down there to check out the city. They run into Lot. Guess where Lot sat, man? He sat in the gate of the city, which shows that Lot was a leader in the city. Lot was in leadership in Sodom, okay? And so Lot says to the angels, come and stay with me. And remember, the angel said, nah, we'd rather stay out here in the street, bro. And then he insisted to stay with Lot. And remember, once they stayed in the house with Lot, all of a sudden, all the men of the city came and started knocking on the door, saying, we saw them angels come in here. We want to sexually have a part of them. In so many words, we want to rape them. We want to fudge pack these angels that came into your house. And guess what? Lot said, Lot opens the door, because they all at the door, and he says to the angels, look, relax, I'll talk to him. And he closes the door behind him, and he says, look here, brothers. Lot had gotten to the point where he didn't even realize. Be with a believer who's supposed to know the Lord, and after a while they can't even tell the difference between what's right and what's wrong, and they're supposed to be Christians. That's how Lot was. And all of a sudden, Lot says, listen, don't do this to these men. I got two daughters in here. Y'all can rape them if you want. This dude done lost his mind. The angels say, you know what, man, get your butt in here. And they grab Lot and throw him inside, and they go out there and they blind everybody. And so after that, they said, you're going to get out of here. The next, we can really burn this place up. You can get out of here. So Lot goes, and they said, if you got anybody in this city you want to save, go tell them. So Lot goes and he talks to his sons-in-law. And guess what he tells them? He says, God will destroy your city. And you know what it says? It says that they thought Lot was joking. You ever see a Christian who just, their life is a joke? When they say something to you, you don't even know if they're telling you the truth. You don't know if they're even joking. You don't know what they're saying. Because they never really told you about God's judgment. You joking, right, man? So Lot leaves the city. Tradition says Lot had four daughters. Lot leaves the city with two of his daughters and his wife. And where did he get this wife from? Probably down in Sodom. So as they're leaving the city, all of a sudden the angels say, don't look back. Guess what? His wife turns around and she looks back, and she starts, actually, literally, it means to look back with a desire to want to go back there because the city's on fire, it's about to burn. And all of a sudden she wants to go back, and all of a sudden she's turned into a pillow of salt. We said before, she's on the side of the Morton salt box. But then all of a sudden they get outside the city and they're in this cave. And remember, the two daughters, probably, that Lot was going to get to the crowd and allowed them to be raped. They said, let's get our daddy drunk and let's rape him. Life completely destroyed because of his what? Flesh. How many of you notice on TV, more and more flesh is being shown? More and more, I read this thing where years ago, people on TV used to be married. Do you remember that? Remember on TV, that you know, used to be, well, the Lucy Show. You remember Lucy Show? She was married to Ricky Ricardo. Remember Leave It to Beaver? They was married one day. Leave It to Beaver. That used to be one of my favorite shows. Some of y'all are like, how old are you? No, they would show these reruns, you know what I'm saying? Even the Flintstones were married. You ever notice that? The Jetsons were married. You ever notice that? You ever know? I used to watch the show The Monsters. You remember that? These wicked people. But even they were married. Then they say in the 70s, all of a sudden these TV shows started coming on in the 70s and 80s, and people aren't married anymore. Three's Company. Right? What kind of foolishness is this? The Love Boat. It's no longer about a family anymore. It's about lust. I read where Will Smith is wicked, so is his wife, Jada. If you get the CD, repent. Will, you too, Jada. And your little weird son, too. All three of y'all need to repent.
Let's not forget the little girl.
Yeah, I don't know her. I haven't read much about her, but I read about the other. Will Smith was involved in a movie. They told him, in this movie, you need to intimately kiss a man. Will Smith said, no, I ain't doing that. You know why he said that he wouldn't do it? He said because when he was a younger actor, Denzel Washington came up to him and said, "Will, okay, brother, whatever you do, do not kiss a man in these movies. It'll bring you down, bro. Don't do it." He said that that's why he wouldn't do it, because of what Denzel Washington had told him. He said, "But now I've learned better." And now shortly after that, they cast him in a movie where he did kiss another man. Anyway. Kick these, and you pay to see these people? Ezekiel. I'll read Ezekiel 16. I'm going to tell you why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Y'all can turn in and do not know. Ezekiel 16, I always say that, but you're really not. Ezekiel chapter 16, look what it says in verse 49. Look at some of the reasons why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. I'll start in verse 48. As I live, Ezekiel, you can turn your Bible probably to the middle and hit it. As I live, says the Lord God, neither your sister Sodom nor her daughters have done as you and your daughters have done, speaking to Israel in their wickedness. Look in verse 49. Look, this was the iniquity of your sister Sodom. She and her daughter had pride. Doesn't it sound a lot like America? Fullness of food. Doesn't it sound like a lot of like this country? They an abundance of idleness. Doesn't it sound a lot like this country? And neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and the needy. Doesn't it sound a lot like this place? Men should be lovers of pleasure. 2 Timothy 3:2, I'm back there again. People should be lovers of money. And let me just say this about lovers of pleasure. You know, it's interesting, you know, we got all this TV and all these movies and all the rest of this stuff, and people are entertained. We are so looked to be entertained. And then all of a sudden, people come to COF, and if I don't make them laugh, if you don't make them laugh or cry, then you have not done your job in their mind. And so people now, even within the church, are entertainment seekers. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul says that when they spoke about him, they said, you know, that his speech was not weighty. His appearance was weak. Paul was evidently a bad public speaker. And the way he looked, tradition says he had runny eyes and a big nose, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't what they loved. He's not the type they would put on TV. See, scripture says that we're living in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, the time when men will not endure, women will not endure sound teaching. But they will give heed to what? Itching ears. They will gather to themselves teachers having itching ears. hear, that will teach them what they want to hear. People will be lovers of money. This is all coming from the flesh. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, you turn in Matthew 6, 24. He says, you cannot have two masters. You will either love one and hate the other. He says, you cannot love God and mammon. You cannot, or material possessions. You cannot. This is why when it comes to giving, people struggle so much because they're thinking, I want this, I want that. What about the kingdom of God? It's because they're a lover of material possessions in Matthew 6, 24. And then before you know, you start hating the things of God. You start hating the time when we have an offering. Jesus said in Matthew 6, verse 32, he says, you weren't sitting around here worrying about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, what you're going to drink. These are the things that unbelievers concern themselves with. He says in verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God. These things will be added to you. Some car, some house, some clothes, all the rest of it, some man, some woman. Get your focus on God. And let me say this too. We'll go another 10 minutes. Let me say this. Listen. Lots of times, the way the enemy works when it comes to our flesh is he does what he can to affect our eyesight. You know, they've done statistics where they said how that if something is red, it draws the attention of another person. So this is why red cars sell more than white cars. People settle for green cars and blue cars, but mainly they either look for a red car or a black car. And most of red cars and black cars are more expensive than the other ones. They've shown that red dresses are more popular than the other color dresses. They've shown that there's something about shiny things that gets people's attention. What we would call now bling. I saw somewhere where now they're taking. How many of you got diamonds? Ms. Francis, I know you got about $100,000 worth of diamonds on you. On you right now, on your finger, right so that, you know. We'll make sure you get out of here, okay. They said now that they have discovered that you can take peanut butter, crystallize it over a period of time, and make diamonds. Look it up when you get a chance. Come find out many of us don't have real diamonds. We got peanut butter on our fingers. But we love shiny things. And it's something when it comes to the lust of the flesh is that the enemy will use the natural desires. The natural desires of the flesh. You know, and we know that from Acts chapter 17 that Paul was dealing with two very popular groups. One was called the Epicureans, and the other were the Stoics. The Epicureans were those that believed that, hey, enjoy life, eat, drink, and be merry. They had a saying, for tomorrow you die. Have you ever heard that before? There was a belief in the early church, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13, that the body was just something to just use and to have a good time with. So they had an old saying, that meat for the belly, belly for the meat. And you know what Paul said? You can go around with that saying if you want. Meat for the belly, belly for the meat. But God would destroy them both. And they were using that to have sexual relationships with people. Well, meat for the belly. Desires for desires. God made us this way. Some people, when it comes to their flesh, God says that they're ruled by their instincts. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, he says they're like brood beasts. Like a beast is all the only thing a beast is concerned about is their natural instincts, whether it be or their natural drives, which is to eat, have sexual relationships, sleep, and what else? Yeah, that too. But then he says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, verse 14, that that's happened to some believers, or to some people, not believers, but people. After a while, they have eyes that cannot stop committing adultery. They become like dogs. They sniff each other. Before you know, they own each other. Somebody say amen. You think he's talking about you now? Come on. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Mm-hmm. Turn to James. James chapter 1. James chapter 1. Why do we sin? Why do people sin? Why do people let their flesh get the best? Why does this happen? How does it happen? As Christians now, we have power over this. Look what it says in verse 14. Verse 13, James says, don't say that you've been tempted. When you're tempted, you were tempted by God, because God tempts no man with evil. So don't say that. But guess what happens? It says in verse 14, we'll close off with this. It says, but each one is tempted when he is or she is drawn away by their own desires or own lusts. When you find someone falling into a situation, what you find out, believe it or not, is that these people had already had this thing going on in their head. Now they just acted it out. That's all. Someone, listen, robs a bank. They've already thought about doing it a long time ago. It's not something that just all of a sudden they just had a thought. That's rare. 99% of the time, it's because it's already there. And then look what it says. Look at the steps. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away with his own lust or own desires. And then there's enticement. There's enticement. So the enticement, this whole thing breaks down. This is our last verse of the day, by the way. Here's, we'll just put lust, and then we'll put enticement or temptation. Guess what? Step one, step two. This step breaks down right here, enticement. Temptation, it stops right here if you deal with this. But guess what? Got that problem on the inside already. So guess what? They've already opened themselves up for temptation. So guess who brings temptation? Satan. Have you ever seen dog racing on TV? They line the dogs up, and usually they put a rabbit, the greyhounds up, and they put a rabbit a fake rabbit on the side of the track. And these greyhounds run as fast as they can, chasing the rabbit, because they want to catch it. Let me say this, when they do this on TV, it has never ever made me once, Miss Francis, want to go out and chase a rabbit. Because I don't have a temptation in that area. It's like, understand how Satan works. He builds a liquor store on the corner. If you don't have a problem with the liquor and the stuff they sell in there, then you're fine. If you got an issue with it, then guess what? He got you. He just puts the temptation out there. Somebody would come running naked down the street. One person says, oh, look at that. Another person says, oh, that's so wicked. Because it ain't in it. Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 30, that the wicked one is coming, he finds nothing within me. And then look at what it says here. And we'll close off. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away with his own lust. And entice, verse 15 of James chapter 1, then when desire or lust has conceived. So once, guess what happens? These things hook up. Lust hooks up with this, and then all of a sudden, they have a baby. It's conceived. This conception, it already happened in the mind. Now it's a physical conception. And guess what? It conceives and it gives birth, and the baby's name is what? Sin. S-I-N. And then that baby grows up. And that baby gets a nickname. You know how they call people Boo and Bobo and JoJo? Well, guess what that baby's nickname is when it's full grown? It produces what? Death. You see, this is how sin operates in our lives as believers. When it comes to our flesh. Next week, we'll look at some things that we can do about this. We'll talk about surgery. It's important that we do surgery. We'll talk about that. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for the time we had together. We love you for your mercy and your grace and your loving kindness, your goodness, and all these things that you've been to us. We pray now, Father, as we close off, that as we go out here and we are tested in these areas and we learned about you today when it comes to temptation, enticement to do evil, God, today when it comes to just all these other things about knowing your word, when it comes to our just living a life that's pleasing to you and dealing with our flesh, we pray this week, Lord, we would get an A, we would pass the test. Our thoughts would be right before you, our heart would be right. We love you, Daddy. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. At the end, Josh, since you haven't been on the mic today, you can tell us have a great day. What song do we have? My song. We have a song here today, and the name of it is My Song. No, I'm just joking. It is by, I need to know the name. Of course, by who? By Derek Minor. And this song talks about how God brought us from the bottom to the top, meaning that he brought us out of just some bad situations. And when you look at it, you say it had to be God. And then you just say, of course. Can we all say that? Of course. Can you say that, Miss Francis? Of course. Can the overflow room folks say it?
Of course.
Okay, so of course. Amen. So the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord give you rest. May he lift his countenance towards you and give you peace. I pray that he would bless you this upcoming week. Father, have your hand upon us all. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. Amen. Josh, tell us that every day, and God bless.
Hallelujah, oh Lord. Where I'm from, it go feet when they bored. When you supposed to be here, pop a cork. God did it, boom, flexing, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course. I ain't gotta worry about a thing anymore. I just, yeah, of course. With a cut of thorns, feeling like a king, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course. Tell me I'm a star, so that I don't need a gas. What I really, really need is good credit and a bag. Mama saw me sign a deal, I told her, there you go. Now I'm waking up in loss, I'm a wolf floor. My pride, I'm a faucet, flex, why out of God sent, got it, so I stress, not about it. I just, I'm a child of hitter, yeah, I'm really cool. Yeah, I'm coming for the squad, get them coughing in the news. Been a king from a king, so my rings got a ring. Now my chains got a gleam, but my soul's been a beam. Well, of course, oh Lord, where I'm from, it go feet when they bored. When you supposed to be here, pop a cork. God did it, boom, flexing, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course. I ain't gotta worry about a thing anymore. I just, yeah, of course. With a cut of thorns, feeling like a king, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course. Ideas to bite, new way to surf on. Yeah. Please prepare the throne. Mr. Minor is home, and I'm done playing your own. Big Doc on the phone. Got some holes with binoculars to duplicate. But they don't see the big pictures, so they can't trace it. I can teach you how to hustle and then finesse it. But have my cheese and my bread, quick, make it deep dish. It's never been about the money for me. It's always been about the kingdom, dummy. I've been talking to the sun, he said the future's sunny. Oh Lord, where I'm from, it go feet when they bored. When you supposed to be here, pop a cork. God did it, boom, flexing, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course. I ain't gotta worry about a thing anymore. I just, yeah, of course. With a cut of thorns, feeling like a king, yeah, of course. Made it out the bottom, of course.
Blessed day in the Lord.
things on the